Antarctica, the pure cold crown of the southern hemisphere. A sanctuary of life, long protected by distance, forever tempting, forever demanding. From the poet Homer, we took the name of his nymph, Calypso. Our beautiful Calypso maidens now become pneumatic to soar with Philip over Antarctic seas. The white continent, twice the size of Australia. A symbol of hope threatened by short-sighted lust for whatever riches there may be buried there. No, it won't be done. I fell in love with Antarctica 18 years ago on board Calypso.
From home base at Monaco on the Mediterranean Riviera, Captain Cousteau and Calypso's crew are ready to depart upon their most ambitious adventure. Visiting dignitaries and members of the world press are on board Calypso when Prince Rainier arrives to wish the expedition well. The French consul is welcomed. For Cousteau, this is a special day. He has long dreamed of and discussed with Saint-Philippe, a journey to the ice-studded seas of Antarctica. Veteran diver Albert Falco discovers he's a celebrity as well-wishers throng Calypso to bid its men bon voyage. The Paris match photographer calls for a last picture of the crew before departure. The ship has been specially equipped for the polar expedition. The photo is taken on Calypso's new helicopter platform. In the family portrait are the divers, crew, and scientists who, with Captain Cousteau, look forward to the challenge of exploring the most remote and hostile waters of the globe. Theirs will be a hazardous journey. One of them will not return. Calypso's first mate, Michel Laval, expert navigator and world adventurer, who after 2 years' absence has rejoined the crew for this mission to Antarctica, now sets Calypso on course for her greatest adventure. Captain Cousteau, who in earlier Arctic expeditions fell in love with northern polar waters, now sails south to make an extensive underwater survey of the Antarctic and to explore the shorelines of the most desolate region on Earth. South to the bottom of the world. In 1773, Captain James Cook and his ship Resolution was the first to cross the Antarctic Circle. Among the legendary explorers who followed in the heroic assault upon the Antarctic, Roald Amundsen, in 1911, the first man to reach the South Pole. Robert Scott, who lost the race to the pole and died in a blizzard. Ernest Shackleton, who in 1915 survived when his ship was crushed by ice. Richard E. Byrd, who in the 1920s established Little America and flew over the pole. And now December 1972, Captain Cousteau and Calypso and crew are to open up the undersea world of the forbidding white continent. From Monaco, Calypso and crew have sailed the North Atlantic southward. They've crossed the equator on their way to the farthest tip of South America. Along the coast of Patagonia, they meet a pod of right whales.
We wonder if the whales, too, are going to the Antarctic, or if they have changed their habits because of extensive whaling there. Here, off Patagonia, they are protected. They raise their young and depart no one knows where. December 5. I commit Calypso to the perilous Drake Passage that lies between the extreme tip of South America and the Antarctic Peninsula. For safety, we depend on space-age techniques. Directly from three satellites, we receive pictures indicating storms and the ice situation in our area.
This is Calypso. Good morning, AOC. We read you loud and clear. Over.
Another satellite, at an altitude of 22,000 miles, connects us by radio to the outside world. Pictures from a weather satellite show that a storm is moving westward in the Drake Passage between Cape Horn and the Antarctic Peninsula.
Et la dépression blanche qu'on avait hier ici se déplace vers l'ouest. Le vent?
20 nœuds, commandant, alors qu'hier il y avait 40-45 nœuds.
Alors, je décide de traverser sans attendre.
On veut prendre quand même une dépression, il y en a une à l'ouest qui est...
As there is usually such a storm in the Drake every 3 days, and our crossing will take 4, there is no way to avoid 24 hours of bad weather. I decide to go. The wind, about 20 knots, is not yet alarming, but the swell is rising and the clouds are low. The whole atmosphere is threatening. The albatrosses are at home here, but at the approach of these polar seas, I feel alien.
J'ai l'impression que ça se gâte. Le vent force régulièrement.
Captain Bougaran, Philippe and I study the satellite photos. We put them together and find there is a depression. A cyclonic storm building up over the Drake Passage. We plot our course against the roughest channel in the world. We will attempt to pass through the outer edge of the storm. In the afternoon of December 7th, the wind turns to southeast and reaches 45 knots. The sea is rough, but I am happy to feel my Calypso, also overloaded with equipment and supplies, ride up the waves like a seagull. I had promised a traditional bottle of rum to whomever would spot the first iceberg.
C'est bien ce que prévoyait la météo. Mon Dieu, qu'est-ce qu'on va déguster?
At dawn on the fourth day, Roger Bruno and Albert Falco win the prize. Without warning, within a couple of minutes, a furious wind struck us. It now reaches 80 miles an hour. The stern anchor does not hold. The ship is drifting. We could be carried to shore and wrecked on the rocks. We must act fast.
Dépêchons-nous, où est la bosse?
L'arrière, vite! Tous à l'arrière!
Rampe décrochée!
Ils sont là!
Oui, nom de Dieu!
On chasse!
Maintenant, ils ne verront plus!
Gardez-moi! Est-ce qu'il y a du jus sur le
oui,
train?
La jarrière! Essayez de remonter l'ancre avec la grue!
The anchor winch is frozen. Our only chance is to try to use the crane. Obviously, Leopard Bay is not a safe anchorage. We must move out as soon as possible. With Captain Bougaran, we decide that a better shelter will be found in Whalers Bay, Deception Island. Our helicopter, piloted by Bob McKeegan and carrying aerial photographer François Charlet, will escort us to the protective bay of Deception Island. The sea is now calm. With the Zodiac off our stern, we follow our reconnaissance helicopter. It looks like a child's toy against the vastness of Antarctica. The storm abated as fast as it arose. Our helicopter escorts us to Deception Island, sinister enough. It served as a base for the whalers at the time of the big massacres. But about 30 years ago, with the advent of factory ships, big floating slaughterhouses, Deception was abandoned. Calypso enters a narrow passage flanked with sheer cliffs that whalers called Neptune's Bellows, Dragon's Mouth, or Hell's Gate. Deception is a caldera, a vast volcanic crater dug out by a tremendous explosion and invaded by the sea. The volcano is still active, about to explode at any moment. Between mountains of rocks exhaling fumes, glaciers dirtied with ashes slowly flow to the sea. Under the snow, hell smolders. It is the improbable wedding of fire and ice. Through clouds of steam, we perceive the ruins of a Chilean research station, completely destroyed in 1969 by volcanic explosions. There have been three explosive eruptions on the island during the last 5 years, and each time, marine charts had to be modified.
The Calypso team inspects the waters from which the vapors rise. Puzzlin puts a thermometer on the water where boiled shrimp have been found. The surface layer is hotter than the 120 degrees the thermometer is able to register.
Philippe steps gingerly over warm volcanic ashes. The air is freezing, but it might be possible to take a warm bath.
Qu'est-ce que tu attends pour aller te baigner?
Ah, c'est chaud, nom de Zeus!
Man's threshold of pain is around 112 degrees. The men try to mix the cold water below with the hot water on the surface. But in this paradoxical land of ice cold and burning, it's impossible. Our heroic bathing beauties are obliged to retreat. Aboard Calypso, continuous measurements of water temperature and chlorophyll content are made. It is a joint research effort with NASA. Far from the shore, the Austral Ocean is as poor as the Mediterranean. But the coastal waters of the Antarctic Peninsula are rich in phytoplankton. It's a big thrill on board, as Philippe, Bonici, Cole, Sumian, and Giacoletto put on their new dry suits for their first Antarctic dive. Other mammals that return to the sea are protected from cold by a thick layer of blubber. As a substitute for fat, we inflate our outer skin with air.
Philippe decides to follow the penguins outbound to the mouth of the bay. Philippe and Christian Bonici take to the water to join the penguins. Bonici finally manages to get a handhold on a protruding piece of ice. But Philippe continues to have an exasperating time. Body surfing on a swell, with Bonici's help, Philippe makes it. Penguins have long toenails to help them climb on ice. But for Philippe, it is still a slippery ordeal. These penguins seem determined to avoid our divers. It was a difficult climb, but there's an easier way down. The excursion continues. A long-snouted crab-eater seal studies the party with lazy nonchalance, while others take to the water. Most of the crab eaters rest quietly, basking in the sun on this bright and miraculous summer's day. Calypso is the first ship ever to carry an expedition devoted exclusively to the undersea exploration of the Antarctic waters. We are attracted by the luster of an enormous tabular iceberg. Icebergs like this are made entirely of fresh water from millions of years of Antarctic snowfalls. They are often measured in miles.
The men will now put their dry suits to an underwater test. The temperature of the water is 30 degrees, but because of its saline content, it does not freeze. Now, their first look at the bottom of Antarctica.
We find the waters turbid as we descend to the base of a fragmented iceberg driven aground. We are surprised to find a rich growth of algae partially gouged out by the iceberg. Icebergs will destroy more of such abundant flora and dig deep scars in the soil as, pounded by swells and pushed by currents, they skew around aimlessly. Diving under an iceberg is dangerous because it could capsize, or a big swell could lift it and pound it down on the divers.
Here, beauty becomes delicate and warm. we glide among motley bouquets, amazed, filled with joy. It seems incredible that this icy water can nourish such abundance. What a contrast to the surface, so stark, so barren, so simple.
These majestic living torpedoes are orcas, nicknamed killer whales, the most powerful predators of the seas. In Antarctica, large whales have become exceedingly rare. However, packs of killer whales still thrive. Each closely knit family includes several females, offspring from two generations, and a single large male, the leader and master, identified by his huge dorsal fin. They feed on fish and squid. Occasionally, they enrich their menu with seals. But they certainly don't deserve the epithet killer more than any other animal. It is the time of the skua. By instinct, penguins fear anything that comes from the sky. With the piercing eyes of an eagle, a skua soars over the nurseries, looking for an abandoned chick or a sick one. A Adélie penguin has protected his baby courageously. The skua, having been repelled several times, now cautiously attempts to grab another chick, one that had moved away to die. He's forced to give it up as the penguin, with fierce eyes and his neck feathers erect, drives him from his prey. Skua is persistent, but his perseverance is no match for the penguin.
Few ports of call for the sea-roaming Calypso are 20th century. But when they are, it's an occasion. Cousteau is adventure. Courage. News.
Cousteau.
He's been a great inspiration to me.
He is someone that is so much bigger than life in many ways.
It had begun with Charles de Gaulle in 1958. Now he travels the world to convince its leaders to save the sea. At the same time, he lobbies the public.
Captain Cousteau perhaps has done more than any other individual to reveal the mysteries of the oceans that cover more than two-thirds of the surface of our planet. It is therefore likely that he will be remembered not only as a pioneer in his time, but as a dominant figure in world history.
He is therefore one of the great explorers of an entirely new dimension. I can imagine his satisfaction in having opened up the ocean floor to man and science. And I can think of no more felicitous award than this to the captain.
Captain Cousteau and President Castro make a tour through the Havana Botanic Garden and visit a high school where students greet the familiar leader and the familiar visitor. The president asks whether the students recognize their guest. They do. Let's see if you know the ship where he works, the president says. Again, they know.
What you're working for is the happiness of your people. But I also have the impression that you think that the only good way for happiness is the way you think. But it reminds me of Ford,
pero me recuerda a mí,
who made his first cars and said, you can choose any color you wish, provided that it's black. Sorry, but...
President Castro tells Captain Cousteau about a record-breaking genetically superior cow, specially bred in Cuba.
2.2 kilograms of milk.
Cousteau compares the cow to a famous coal miner. Yes, agrees the president, this cow took all records.
La máxima producción.
In fact, the cow is so famous, a monument will be erected to her.
Because if they raise ashes to the...
All the world, Fidel Castro is represented as a big cigar.
The curious, the concerned, the well-wishers welcome him. Their most common question, how can I help? Cousteau's most frequent reply, love life. Perhaps above all, it is this capacity of Cousteau to love all life, which prompts to memory vivid images of his total commitment to the sea. For Cousteau, what's past is indeed prologue. Many tasks lie ahead, some to begin, some to complete, and time has a way of running out.
So that you can continue to fly kites, so that you can join us in adding another chapter to the greatest adventure of all time. An error of management today could seriously jeopardize the fate of future generations.
Our Earth stands alone, a life-supporting oasis in an otherwise barren solar system. In the 20th century, pollution has emerged as one of the major threats to the delicate balance that sustains life on our planet. Man's appetite for resources often harbors dire consequences. As we convert raw materials into consumer products, our environment is subject to ever-increasing stress. The waste we create today will haunt us tomorrow. Industrial pollution and the flagrant overuse of our resources are not self-correcting. Not content to use his powers of reason and physical dexterity for mere adaptation, man takes the biosphere into his own hands. Though he celebrates life in his art and science, he threatens many species with extinction. Though he builds ingenious vessels, he also poisons the oceans. Though he creates cathedrals, he also builds monuments to waste and destruction.
What we intend to do in the coming years, let's not say the second 75 years, but I have made a decision for the next years that I will live. I will make all my efforts to implement the most utopian project I've ever designed. I would like to see 1% of the military budgets, 1%, dedicated to a vast exchange of children. Imagine a world where all the children from 7 to 8, for example, would have to spend a year on the other side of the fence. It would be, from the educational standpoint, of course, a great opening to their minds, but it also would be a formidable barrier against war.
At a surprise ceremony, I am solemnly presented with a crystal sword by Maurice Druon, perpetual secretary of l'Académie française. The transparency of my new weapon will be a pledge of sincerity in our fights for the generations to come. For me, the meaning of my election to the Academy is the necessity to embark in the future without breaking from the past. It is time to defend the rights of those who will replace us on this planet. Look at the youth of the world. We have a single gift for them: enthusiasm for a life of dignity. We have a duty to respect the diversity and variety of ethnic origins, languages, and customs. The great communication networks must be employed to amplify the symphony of the world, not the monotonous hum, which will signify its decadence. We must give every human child access to education, art, poetry, and philosophy. No, the manufacture of atomic bombs does not bring us closer to this goal. Luckily, the level of public opinion has helped me move mountains. 1,500,000 French people signed my petition for the protection of Antarctica, fulfilling my dream to preserve the planet's last virgin continent. To celebrate this victory, now I return with an unusual team, 6 young ambassadors of the future, from Australia, North and South America, Europe, Asia, and Africa, to take symbolic possession of their property. Santiago, our meeting point where Geronimo, the delegate from Chile, greets his new companions and completes the group. The children meet the press for the first time in their lives. Proud, but still uneasy. While I present the planned voyage into the scientific and natural wonders of Antarctica, a trip intended to launch not only learning, but hope. Elie Zotzenberger, Kelly Matheson, Corey Gilmer, Oko Shio, Fumiko Matsumoto, Geronimo Brunner. Six average children, 11 years old, who had traveled thousands of miles, unknown to each other when they were selected to take on the unknown ahead. While the crew loads the tons of equipment, the children become children again, taking over every corner of their new playground, even the vast rattling engine hall. They are far less eager to expose the status of their rooms when I take a look.
Where do you sleep, Gerald? You're sitting down?
Yes, but what?
No,
my clothes! Those are my clothes!
In this atmosphere of good wishes and good weather, children and adults prepare for a first night at sea. A first night in a new bed. A first night with new friends. A first night of new experience where to be a child would be to embody the aspirations of all the children in the world. At last, Erebus casts off from Punta Arenas. Slowly falls behind as Erebus follows the Patagonia channels bound for the Antarctic Ocean. For children far from home, sea and horizon bestow a new world, as do the glaciers now melting under the warming hand of austral summer. They overflow with questions and the curiosity of escapading young minds.
Last night, we left and we proceeded.
During the crossing, the children learned the rudiments of navigation.
We expect to arrive in Port William tonight, by maybe 1 o'clock in the morning.
Magellan was convinced that the world could be circumnavigated. He would use the sun and the stars to position his ships. Small vessels tossed by violent storms, his men sailed in apprehension of the sea of darkness. While Magellan forced a strait leading to undiscovered oceans, through the solid landmass at the end of the world, his superstitious sailors were afraid that giant sea serpents would rise out of the waves to demolish their ships and consume them.
For young novices, I had never dreamt of such a dazzling welcome.
Look at that! Allez, là,
four humpback whales, fluid grace under power, swim flamboyantly close to our vessel. Hunted without mercy, the humpbacks have become very rare.
Ah, à tribord!
Baleine, droit devant!
During our entire voyage, we will see no more of them. Before she disappears, our whale extends one of her long pectoral flippers, as if to wave goodbye.
We are now underway to Potter Cove in King George Island, South Shetland, where we hope to arrive this evening despite strong westerly winds that are raising a growing sea.
We have come during the short Antarctic summer, otherwise this bay at King George Island would be fast with sea ice. Suddenly, we hear a calving glacier. We fear we are going to be submerged by the fantastic wave, but amazingly, its force is reabsorbed by the ice rising back to the surface. We are relieved by this shock-absorbing phenomenon. We are met by two adelie penguins who lead us to an open graveyard of whale bones left by whalers who rendezvoused here. Philippe turns his attention to the welcoming committee. Like most animals that have never met man, the penguin is curious. But he refuses to shake hands and maintains his independence. From plane to ship to penguin stone, we are now cautious visitors in a fragile mythical land. This coast of King George Island was covered with snow during my first expedition. We tread carefully in what was once a butcher's corner, where legendary whalers dragged their defeated haul, leaving only bones behind. The great blue whale was reassembled by my crew in 1972. The beach presents a vision out of Dante, an appalling ossuary. It was on land that former whalers cut up their victims. Hundreds of whale jaws, a multitude of ribs and vertebrae are scattered on the ground. We become amateur paleontologists. Under the supervision of Dr. Dugy, we attempt to reconstruct the skeleton of a big blue whale. The skull alone weighs more than 800 pounds. The whole team is needed to move it. For Dr. Dugy, it is a gigantic jigsaw puzzle. The rostrums of the upper jaws average 15 feet in length. These animals, the largest that ever existed, are beautiful, peaceful, and intelligent. Their last survivors are still ingloriously slaughtered by butchers to be transformed into oil and food for dogs and cats. This is our whale. Almost a fossil, a 90-foot monument to the folly of man. By satellite on board Calypso, I hold an international press conference.
Encore 10 minutes d'antenne.
What I was saying is that the abundance of life in the Antarctic
at the level of primary production, of the vegetable production, is enormous. And the first beneficiaries of this production, with only one intermediary, which was the krill, the mass of little shrimps, red shrimps, which abound in this area, were the whales. Now, these whales have been decimated. There is only 6% of them left today, about. So that a tremendous amount of unused food is now used by less interesting forms of life, like starfish, for example. So that because of the poor management of man with the whales, there is a continuous waste of biological resources in the ocean today. Over.
I decide to drop anchor in a bay of King George Island.
La barre est
5
à gauche.
Zéro.
La barre est 0. La barre est à 0.
Treeless and with not a single land animal, the Antarctic is an environment so severe that it also has had no native human populations.
It is snowing when we land in Leopard Seal Cove. With us is Dr. Raymond Duguy of the Paris Museum of Natural History. How long has it been since this cabin was visited last? This was obviously a meteorological station. After the explorers came the scientists. Weather observations were essential for climate studies and to safeguard ships that ventured into this region. People have suffered here to serve mankind. But today, their work is done far better by satellites without risking human lives. Snow has penetrated everywhere, but here are mattresses, books once read, cans of food still unspoiled, and on a table, condiments left behind. For 13 years, the building has been unattended. Yet it is as if it were only yesterday. Antarctica preserves everything, but one feels that here, life hangs only by a thread. Ice has crushed ships, scattering their fragments in the snow. The Antarctic has driven the bravest and toughest to exhaustion and desperation, such as Robert Scott, who in 1912 gave his life in the name of discovery. Nearby, on a windswept promontory of ice and rocks, a line of tombs marked by weathered wooden crosses.
Les noms sont gravés.
Four young Englishmen lost their lives here. The crosses evoke all who have died for knowledge in Antarctica. Pensive, we walk down toward the deserted shore. In spite of her modern equipment, today Calypso appears to me very fragile. To the children, I explained that British scientists died here, heirs to a long tradition of daring explorers.
The Antarctic has already many victims. We don't want too many more.
The British base was abandoned in 1962. On our first visit, the crew of Calypso was entirely alone on the windswept peninsula. Now, a Brazilian scientific base is being resupplied here. Since 1959, an international treaty has consecrated Antarctica to peace and science. This model of harmony and cooperation has allowed different nations to conduct research in a pristine natural laboratory that preserves a record of the planet before human alteration. The government of Poland operates Artovsky's scientific station, its personnel extending open arms to the six intrepids, escorting them through an experimental greenhouse.
I don't know exactly so good English to explain you to... No. Polish, Russian, English, but no so good, of course.
What do you do here?
What I'm doing? Yes, okay, I'm geophysicist on this station, on Artovsky station.
Only a radiophone link could be established with Yuri, the chief of the base, yet enough to nurture understanding on the destiny of Antarctica.
We came here in the Antarctic with six children from each continent.
It's a good opportunity for me to say welcome for children's different continents which now on board of your ship. Or
I told you that children are very much interested in the project making a natural reserve of the Antarctic.
I wonder what the Russian scientists think about it.
It's my opinion that Antarctica is a future for our kids, and I hope we'll keep Antarctica clean, and I hope only scientific cooperation, and I hope in future make Antarctica like a world park. Or
that's wonderful. I agree with you entirely, and thank you very much.
Okay, merci.
Perhaps indeed the last continent touched by humans can be the first that humans set aside. Icebergs and ice blocks drift by, one after another, endlessly. Pushed by westerly winds and currents, some of them have probably circled all around the Antarctic continent. The oldest ones, half melted, having capsized several times, present fantastic shapes and extraordinary shades of blue. These mountains of ice may be majestic, but they are dangerous for navigation. Summer is at an end, and we know that the season changes here are drastic. But we want to go on with our work for as long as we can. En route to Esperanza, Hope Bay, at the entrance of the Weddell Sea, Calypso makes her way between islands, reefs, and icebergs. Cette espèce de yo-yo.
Ah oui.
Like a yo-yo, a hummock of ice bobs, oscillating in resonance with a long swell.
Véritable yo-yo. C'est curieux. Avec le courant, il dérive vers le sud.
Eh bien,
le passage n'est pas très large.
Et il faudra passer à droite.
Antarctica holds 90% of the world's ice, vital to climate balance. Scientific coring into ice sheets, sometimes 2,000 meters thick, unlocks both samples of the past and warning for the future. Ice is always being born in Antarctica, an indispensable source of planetary cold. Changes in temperature could melt some of the ice and raise ocean level. December 9th, weather is improving. From the helicopter pad newly assembled on the stem of Calypso, I take off with our pilot, Bob McKeegan. 200 years ago, Captain Cook wrote that nowhere had he observed so much life as in these polar seas. That life, what has become of it today? Out in the open sea, I spot a large group of seals. On my way back, I am happy to find that entire islands are still inhabited by immense colonies of penguins by the hundreds of thousands. A group of penguins are drifting slowly on an eroded ice block. This raft of ice is deeply furrowed, indicating that it has been long used by the penguins as a hunting base. They have been traveling aboard all winter long, but as the mating season approaches, their breeding instinct compels them to swim back to their rookeries. They swim like porpoises. Vocalize madly to attract their mates. Penguins are essentially monogamous. Most of them remain faithful to their partners from one mating season to the next. The couples part when they go to sea. Now, after an 8-month separation, the female identifies her mate by his voice. The reunions are as passionate as the courtship rituals of the new fiancés. The mother feeds her chick pre-digested shrimp. He seems to like it. Males and females take turns feeding their progeny and fishing at sea. Newborn penguins are cold-blooded. Parents, whose temperature is 100 degrees, incubate their young as carefully as they do their eggs. To keep feeding all the hungry little ones, the adults must go to the sea. On the slopes, there is an endless coming and going. The sharp-toothed leopard seal, one of their few enemies, awaits them at the water's edge. It's only along the shoreline, in turbid water, but the leopard seal has a chance to seize a penguin by surprise. Falco keeps the peace. There will be no hunting today. More than any other creature, the penguin is the emblem of Antarctica. And I think of all the children growing up today in a world of concrete and asphalt, unable to imagine such wilderness can still exist. The children instinctively avoid intrusion at the almost limitless rookery near the Polish base.
Coming back from a trip, they're going to gorge themselves with kill.
feeding on tiny shrimp-like creatures. They have no predators other than killer whales, leopard seals, and the skua birds.
And thus passes a relaxing afternoon at sea.
The trip took them away from school, but teacher Shirley Burchill gives classes in geography and biology, while the six keep journals of feelings and first-time events.
Okay. So, Lisa, on this map here, where are we going to be?
Because he showed us that.
Yeah, he said we'll stop there.
No, he said we'll be around there.
No, he didn't.
And then tomorrow we'll be in the sea.
Amazing us all, our ship's doctor, an addict of frigid swimming, takes his daily dose. Children too take a break with instructor Shirley and staff member Carole Scipion. Perform a Japanese song learned from Fumiko after a fashion. The expedition sails the Neumayer Channel, en route to the site of the first serious stain on Antarctica.
Planned trip.
Okay, thank you. Well, to the moon. Take the first one.
Then we reach Bernal by the south. On the station. Then we go.
Domain of air, light, water, and sculpted ice, Antarctica at times defies the human gaze and the depth of human reflection. Under darkening skies, we make our way to Palmer Station, an American scientific base where tourism has rendered both pleasure and peril. In January 1989, the Bahia Paraiso, an Argentinian supply and tourist ship, ran aground just outside the base, leaking oil, smothering life. We prepare to film and explore the wreck 1 year later.
Un petit peu des fois ici. Mais c'est tout, pas beaucoup.
For the children, it is a moment of apprehension, of observing, of helping, down to the last hair to be kept clear of the pinching dry soup.
Ah,
taking the TGA?
Bob Talbot.
Oh, Bob Talbot is taking. And the nine?
Chuck Davis.
And who's putting the lights on? Clay?
Clay Wilcox.
Clay, wonderful.
Yeah.
Fine.
Merci. À tout à l'heure.
Where's Chuck?
Shoot! Go ahead. Have a good luck.
Bye-bye, Corey. Oh! Great.
It will not be an inviting dive. Winter played havoc with the ship, grinding it down so it now resembles the submerged rocks that scarred its fate. The wreck was a major disaster for Antarctica.
Okay, everybody ready?
Yeah.
One, two, three.
An unnatural proliferation of algae has colonized the hull, thriving in the organic pollution of leaking diesel fuel. Wild Antarctic weather at first tore the stranded ship loose, setting it more dangerously adrift, only to trap it again, crack it like an eggshell, turn it almost fully upside down. Far from logistical support, the ship is unlikely to be salvaged. Though about 60,000 gallons of oil remain on board during our dive, out of reach. The spill spoiled vital experiments and invaded rookeries. The United States estimated the oil contacted most of the roughly 30,000 seabirds in the area, its long-term effects unknown. Mute witness to the futility of cleanup in unearthly conditions. The ship epitomizes distress that could never be remedied, as industry would only multiply inevitable accidents. Before the eyes of children, the ship was a monument to impotence, still sinking, still seeping.
Voilà. Ensuite, tu tournes par ici, voilà.
Ah, you have one. Bravo. Bring it over there.
Antarctica can belong only to the future. To stand for possession, The children begin to build a house of ice. The entire team pitches in to construct the igloo, supervised by Bertrand Charrier.
More uniform, more consistent?
No way.
Come out of the way. Hey, come out. Ah, here is Oko. Here is Kelly. Et puis, qu'est-ce qu'il y a encore?
Bertrand.
Alors, Bertrand, l'architecte.
Then the ceremony, brandishing the flag of tomorrow.
This is a symbol. A symbol that the Antarctic. You are taking over the Antarctic for future generations, for your children and grandchildren. Not for yourself, but for your children and grandchildren, okay? So we're going to put this in front of the house. Something like this. Voilà. Okay. That's great.
Hold on. C'est formidable. Et donc, il y a même un siège. Oh là là, qu'est-ce qu'on est bien.
A perfect shelter, spacious inside, glistening, white, alive with memories and hope. Kelly and Oko are chosen to sleep once on land, declaring by their presence that adults should hear their voice.
Hey, you guys, good morning. Hey, come on, wake up. It's really sunny outside.
In the morning, Shirley brings breakfast in bed, completing a symbolic night in a symbolic home.
Do you hear the glacier?
Oh, I got some sandwiches too.
Is that good?
Because it's too sunny now.
It's lighter in here than I expected, yes. Huh? Bertrand, sandwich?
Yes,
there you go.
Perhaps in the name of future generations, our generation can preserve forever the distant land of life, so vital to our own. 2 weeks later, we returned to the point where we began. Once anonymous children who had never given interviews and were timid in the limelight are asked for autographs, eagerly signed. Children are rarely questioned for their opinion, but now the global media would seek their views.
Kelly, what did it look like when you got there?
Well, it was partly white, but there was little patches of rock which are left, and it was just amazing to see.
Beautiful, says Oko. It should be kept as it is. No frontier like the old Berlin Wall. Now experienced witnesses with the right to be heard at their international school. They freely share observations, fielding questions from friends. Is it flat or are there hills?
Plus aucune colline.
More like mountains and glaciers that fall in the sea.
Un petit bout dans la mer. C'était tout blanc.
All white and calm, Fumiko remembers.
How many hours were there in one day? There wasn't any night at all. It was all the time day. If you had done at the Antarctic. How did you escape to them and what were them?
We didn't run into any danger and... Kelly, now that you have all these proofs of how Antarctica is beautiful, what are you going to do so that the people stop mining? How are you going to make this way to stop them from mining?
I suppose we could sign petitions to say not to go mining in the Antarctic. And Australia and France, which don't really want to mine down there, and we've got kind of a chance of not mining down there. So.
Did you eat canned food? Did you see many animals? Elise, who represented Europe, tells how they gently approached the seals, who stayed with them, just as gently.
Et déjà les avoir approchés autant, c'est déjà génial.
We have not sighted another ship in weeks. Often I am vaguely haunted by a fantasy that we are alone. But beyond the horizon, there is no longer a landfall. For the sun draws reason to the surface, and my thoughts return to our primary mission, to observe and record on film the life song of the sea.
Calypso cameramen must constantly struggle with poor visibility, turbulent currents, and pressure problems. But their greatest concern is keeping the interior of their cameras dry. The results of their unimaginable patience and stamina can be annihilated even by the slightest leak. Hence, detail stripping, desalting, and reassembly of the 326 pieces of a flooded precision instrument takes priority over all other ships' work. But not for long. For the team of 29 who man Calypso, life aboard is an incessant labor. Repair and re-repair, improvise and re-improvise. And when it's all fixed, all fashioned, refix it and refashion it all over again. The work requires pros, men who've got guts and brains, and few romantic illusions. There are no Conrads here. No Melvilles, no Lowrys. Only realists with two or more trades. Only men who can endure, ignore or shrug off long confinement. The perpetual rack and pitch of Calypso. The endless cacophony of wind, sea, machinery, and other men's work. And when it isn't fix it, it's scrub it or paint it. An endless fight against corrosion, peeling, blistering.
Whatever the job, complex or mundane, the men of Calypso do it and they do it well. They all know that they are vital parts of a collective endeavor, that our discoveries will be seen by millions of television viewers, and that our awe will echo in the hearts of young people worldwide. Work aboard Calypso is also no 9-to-5 proposition. For while there are intermittent meals and sleep breaks, the work is continuous. But then, of course, there is always the unexpected. At times, I find myself flirting with the morbid seduction of lassitude. The constant breakdowns, repairs, delays empty me of resolve. And in the bilges of my mind, I deeply resent anything and anybody which interrupts our dreams of action. Even the necessity of dry docking or taking on fuel and provisions becomes adversity. And in the blackest of my black moments, when my imagination has worn thin, I feel I can no longer tolerate this constantly rocking and dripping ship. Its bugs, chlorinated water, its deafening noises, even the bell calling us to meals. Our poor cook, I hate him too for competing to make our stomachs the focus of our expeditions. Even the joyous interruptions of our infrequent mail calls demoralizes me. And then, those agonizing questions. Am I sincere? Why am I doing all this? And who, after all, cares? Only the tiny seas of my cells reply, reminding me, too, that I am the sea, and the sea is me. I know, too, that sometimes the men of Calypso hide moments of loneliness and desperation. But somehow, this breed of man can always find a way out of darkness. Michel Laval and Dr. Dugui have gone to search for fossils on King George Island. Two skuas charge them. The men fear for their eyes.
Michel, un autre! Hey! Tu nous attaques? Non, non, ce n'est pas une attaque. Ils voulaient nous intimider.
Dive attacks were only meant to chase away the intruders and protect the eggs. After the failure of her intimidation maneuvers, the female skua now sits firmly on her nest to defend it. Michelle is responsive to the bird's distress. With gentleness and quiet persuasion, he tries to convey his good intentions. The bird calms down, gaining some confidence. Another animal that does not deserve its reputation for ferocity. Under her breast feathers, Michelle can feel her still pounding heart. Here. Under her breast feathers, Michelle quiets her pounding heart. At the frontier of Antarctica's lonely wastes, two different species, man and skua, brought together by chance, have come to tolerate each other. Michel leaves, knowing too well that such moments are merely brief exceptions to the laws of nature. In difficult weather conditions, the helicopter delivers me to a barren hill. I have been informed by radio that Michel Laval has found fossils here.
Alors, on a trouvé des merveilles.
Vous avez trouvé des choses?
C'est terrible.
Attends.
Il y a celle-là, là, qui cette. Cette feuille, là, il y a une petite branche que l'on voit là, et cette feuille qui est ici, dont on voit également l'empreinte.
Ah oui. Et on voit la branche.
Ouais, l'empreinte est également ici. Là, il y a exactement là, donc, la même feuille, puisque c'est la partie femelle. Et alors derrière, ici, il y a également des feuilles qui sont très évidentes, là, qui ressemblent à une sorte de feuille de...
It is impossible that plants and trees could ever have grown in such frozen soil.
Alors,
however, here are fossilized leaves. They bear a striking resemblance to those found today in the forests of Patagonia. 170 million years ago, this land was part of Gondwana land, a supercontinent. It was connected to India and South America. When that supercontinent broke up, Antarctica drifted toward the pole, where it was covered with ice.
In further pursuit of the phenomenon of the Antarctic, Philippe Cousteau has organized a mountain climbing party to ascend from Deception's vapor shores to the crater of a glacier. Its general location had been indicated to Cousteau by glaciologist Dr. Norman W. Tenbrink of Ohio State University. They will attempt to explore rifts 100 feet deep, blown out by volcanic explosions, which may reveal the climatic history of the region.
A climbing team led by Michel Laval has been improvised. Our aim is to reach and explore the deep fracture in a glacier that was blown up during the 1969 eruption. Michel Laval is an experienced mountain climber. The others, including Philippe, are novices.
Our progress is difficult on granulous, red, lukewarm lava. Everywhere snow is melting and the soil is streaming with water that turns it into mud. Within the cracks it is so hot that water is vaporized. The entire side of the mountain appears to be covered with volcanic vomit.
Avec ce sacré brouillard, on est complètement paumé. Tu crois que c'est par là?
Je crois, mais j'en suis pas certain. Dans cette purée de poids.
The fog makes it difficult for Michel Laval to find the right approach to the glacier.
C'est bon, allons-y.
Attends. D'après moi, enfin, on devrait longer le versant à gauche du monticule.
On the plateau of the glacier, the men, now in cold weather parkas, plod on. They experience a dangerous whiteout as land and sky blend. The course is set by Michel. Safety lines are fastened in the event that one of them falls into a bottomless crevasse. With his ice axe, Michel probes for hidden crevasses.
Here the glacier must be at least 100 feet thick, and the pattern of the cracks is treacherously irregular. We are apprehensive, tense. One more crevasse, much wider and deeper than the others. Michel probes for a long time. Then he goes over and immediately secures me.
Michel calls instructions on where to cross. He has anchored himself as he hauls in rope that will break Philippe's fall if the cornice collapses.
We follow Michel, doing exactly as he tells us. A feeling of malevolent spirits around us, of imminent drama, pervades me. If only that fog would lift.
It is satanic, a hell that has frozen over, steaming and fuming, ready to explode again. The blown-out face of the glacier displays layers of volcanic ash that alternate with snows of successive Antarctic winters. Like the growth rings of a tree, they date past eruptions.
Like the growth rings in a tree trunk, these layers allow us to date past eruptions. They also indicate all the climatic changes as far back as 1670. It will be 2 a.m. when we return to Calypso, exhausted.
The next day aboard Calypso, it is Christmas Eve. Il est mort, le poète. When the poet died. When the poet died, they buried his star in a great field of wheat. All his friends shed their tears. Michel was our poet, and this was to be his last Christmas. December 28. Michel Laval lost his life in an accident, instantly killed by the tail rotor of the helicopter while on the ground close to the volcanic crevasse of Deception. Nature reclaimed him on the border of the unknown. Dreadful day. Throughout his life, Michel sought new horizons. For him, the world was to marvel upon and to love. Calypso's flag is at half-mast. It is my painful task to bring Michel's body back. In my sorrow, I was inclined to drop everything. But Philippe, who had become Michel's friend, offered to remain on the island of fire and ice and to continue the exploration until my return. Only his decision could bring some warmth back into my heart. For 9 days, the shore team, left to themselves on that accursed island, will establish camp in the ruins of a British base and make extensive exploration dives all around Deception. Michel had been captivated by Antarctica, its rich seas, its waste of ice, its transparent beauty. All that lies ahead of us will be inseparable from the memory of Michel Laval. It was thus that we participated in Professor Picard's experiments. In Dakar, we helped the preparation of his Batiscaf FNRS2 that proved to be too fragile. Then, accompanied by the Elie Monnier, a Navy ship I captained for 2 years, we made the first successful dives of the FNRS3 built by the Navy. At the bottom of the Mediterranean, off Toulon, at 2,000 meters. Deeper was done, but we still had to stay longer and to travel farther. At the CIMA, a two-person diving saucer is being developed. Its compact size is compatible with installation aboard the Calypso. Good visibility, maneuverability, and the capacity to function at 350 meters below the sea open up the new horizons I was eager to discover. But recovery of the saucer in foul weather remains a problem and requires agility from all on board. I am eager to take down the diving saucer to explore the deeper polar waters. It's the first time ever that a submarine has been used in Antarctica.
Allô, passerelle. Le cap.
Falco will pilot the saucer while I film.
Okay, passerelle.
At my disposal, I have a remote-controlled exterior camera mounted on a tripod. We dive alongside an iceberg to the bottom, where it is grounded at a depth of 1,000 feet. As we reach the bottom, I am struck by the abundance of life. We advance through clouds of small fish. Immense starfish with multiple arms litter the rocks and the sediment. probably dazzled by our lights, small fish bump into the starfish, get ensnared, and will be devoured. A strange, thin crab, all legs, proceeds as if in slow motion. He looks like a tall, bodiless spider. Our old friend the octopus seems to be as much at ease in these cold waters as in the Mediterranean. A blue fish with white and black spots, like an enameled shell. Falco checks to see if it is alive.
Vous savez ce que c'est, cette chose-là?
Ça, alors? Non, c'est rien.
This incredible creature is a cilentroid. The strange ball attached to the rock by a filament is both a mouth and a digestive tract. Its worm-like extension, which measures over 6 feet, is covered with venomous cells which paralyze shrimp before our eyes. It twists and curls around its prey and contracts slowly to bring the victims to its mouth. It's terrifying. A jelly-like creature swinging like a Christmas bell. A pink snailfish waves lazily, digging out small prey from the diatomic ooze. Out of the depth, the favorite diet of Weddell seals, squid. The saucer's lights are reflected by pigments within their translucent bodies, which are probably fluorescent. This is the first time that live squid have been observed in the Antarctic. Another species of squid with wings of transparent gauze. Now the ice fish, the elusive and almost legendary ice fish, which has no red cells in its blood, therefore no hemoglobin to combine with oxygen and convey it. It is dissolved oxygen only that is carried by the colorless liquid pumped by its heart. The ice fish has never been filmed before in its natural environment. When the temperature goes below 28 degrees, the ice fish releases into its blood a special protein, much like a driver puts antifreeze in his radiator. The teeming world we live below thrives at the very edge of life. In water, 1 or 2 degrees colder, nothing would survive.
On est resté 4 heures au fond. Ça passe vite.
Falco aims upward the jet nozzles that propel the saucer, thus indicating our location to Calypso, so we can be hoisted out of a rapidly freezing sea.
First saucer dive, there would be many more to penetrate the mysteries of the Antarctic deep. It is night when Philippe returns. Here, in December, there is only 1 hour of darkness. The brief, bone-chilling night gives Philippe and the Calypso crew some idea of what the Antarctic winter must be when the sun disappears completely for months on end.
Allez, on verra demain.
Et la dépression blanche là, qu'on avait hier ici.
Dr. François gives Cousteau pictures of the strange fish photographed from the saucer. The pictures and data will be transmitted via satellite to NASA's Ames Research Center at Moffett Field, California, within minutes. On the expedition, Cousteau is to send a flow of data that will hopefully expand our knowledge of Antarctica.
January 16, we proceed to the Melchior Archipelago for refueling, essential before we venture further south. Our providential supply ship is the Bahia Aguirre of the Argentinian Navy.
Attention! À fond, doucement! Doucement! Tiens bon! Restez pas dessous!
Sur la barre, maintenant!
In a disquieting fog, our Calypso heads for regions that are increasingly unsafe. Facing south, we have crossed the Antarctic Circle 200 years and 2 days after British explorer James Cook first passed it in 1773. January 23, NASA warns us that towards the south, the Bellingshausen Sea is frozen 120 nautical miles further north than last year. Fragments of ice increasingly obstruct our course, but weather is fine. And we all want to reach Seal Country and dive under the ice pack there. Now we are about to slip into a narrow channel flanked by cliffs of ice. 3 a.m., the break of day. The low sun rays play through layers of polar air and create mirages and incandescent glow. But the blocks of ice that impede our progress are not mirages. Launches are dispatched ahead in an attempt to push the largest out of our way. The observation chamber in front of our stem is made of thick steel and acts as a bumper. But I fear for our props and rudders that are not protected. Unsuccessfully, we struggle against a chaos of ice that is thickening. For the first time, I become worried. What if Calypso became surrounded with ice to the point of being unable to move? I think of Shackleton, whose sturdy ship, the Endurance, was crushed like a nut in 1915.
On n'y arrivera jamais, ils vont trop vite.
I send a helicopter on a reconnaissance flight. Bob McKeegan and Philippe will look for a way out of the trap. They keep radio contact with the bridge. Calypso and the helicopter will rendezvous near a very old iceberg grounded in the channel. At last, we have found an access to free water, sprinkled only with whiskey ice. We all breathe a bit easier. We have gotten off lightly, with only a few scratches on the hull. This magic bay, luminous, bathed with crystalline water, is Seal Country.
With the chill of advancing winter in the air, blue-eyed cormorants feed in the abundant sea and flock for mass migration to warmer waters. Cormorants gather within a cluster of islets that Cousteau discovers as a refuge for Antarctic wildlife. He calls it Port Calypso. Philippe Cousteau leads an expedition to a hidden cove in which helicopter reconnaissance has unexpectedly disclosed a small herd of fur seals.
We are happy to find that the regal fur seals, plundered for their glossy, dense pelts to the point of extinction, seem to be making a comeback here. In this paradise, virtually inaccessible to man, the seals play and preen their foot-long whiskers. discovery of the fur seals in their isolated rocky cove will provide a rare opportunity to film the sportive creatures both above and below the water. The fur seals are currently protected by the Antarctic Treaty. Now they are unafraid of man, and their behavior is practically undisturbed by the presence of their fellow flippered visitors. For the fur seals, the sea is not the only arena for fun and games. There is also courtship on the rocks. A flirtatious young female pursues a handsome bull. She nips him on the neck and wins him by a whisker. We leave the fur seals, hoping that all nations will continue to honor the Antarctic Treaty and leave them to thrive. These improvised sleds, loaded with diving equipment, make me feel like we are playing explorers of old. The ice pack is cracking. We may not come back walking. We may need boats.
Hey, hop! C'est bon!
Calypso is made fast to the pack as to a wharf in a harbor. Yet, I am concerned. The sea is freezing. Our launches try to churn loose the ice freezing around Calypso that could lock her in within a few hours. We must depart before nightfall. To achieve such round, smooth hulls, the Weddell seals Noah through ice 6 feet thick.
Alors, il y en a un qui était là, et l'autre qui est là-bas.
Malade, t'as enrhumé.
Voilà, mon petit père, pour la postérité.
C'est là tout seul qui se prend.
C'est un jouet d'enfance, ça. On peut essayer les deux, hein, c'est pas interdit. Essayons les deux.
We will slightly enlarge two holes. Philippe and Simeon will be able to dive through one of them, and in case of trouble, come back up through the other. Weddell seals are fantastic divers. They are able to stay underwater up to an hour, to reach depths of 2,000 feet, and to swim under the ice for more than 5 miles. It's not quite the case with us.
Sur la chair, hein, sur, carrément. Non, non, sur la chair, parce que mon néoprène est coupé. Je vais mettre dessus.
In our acoustical cyclorama, we can hear the seals calling from miles around. Greenish microscopic algae coat the solid ceiling. Weddell seals spend a harsh winter beneath the ice, where it is warmer than above. From the unfathomed darkness come sounds from seals foraging hundreds of feet below.
Weddell seals are incredible divers. They can stay almost an hour underwater and can swim up to 5 miles under the ice. They use their sonar to relocate their breathing holes after foraging in the depth.
Curieux.
Oui, c'est le sphinx.
It is a great white sphinx, recalling the Egyptian monster with its human head and the body of a reclining lion. It is grounded, but if tossed by the swell, it could break up or capsize.
Soyez prudents!
Hope Bay. A narrow, deep submerged glacier valley at the entrance to the Weddell Sea. Philippe and the filming team are on their way to explore the ruins of an ice castle.
One has to come close to the Sphinx to realize the enormity of its mass. It is so vast and heavy that the powerful swell breaks on it as on a coastline. The waves charge into caves at the base of the giant. 100 feet away from a concealed tunnel, the water spouts out. The entire structure is a labyrinth of passages and caves. I think of the thousands of years necessary to accumulate snow into such a gigantic block. Then, how many years of sun, of waves, of cold, and of storms were needed to carve out this mass and make it what it is today.
Est-ce qu'elle tient la glace?
We will try to board the island of ice. We use the swell as a lift to attain a grasp.
Je casse pas la gueule.
Il n'y a pas de prise.
Christian is the first to climb the slippery wall. He is followed by Dominique, who then helps Raymond and me. At any moment, under inside stresses of fantastic magnitude, the colossal sculpture could explode, disintegrate into innumerable pieces, annihilating Calypso and all of us. The thought obsesses me. The iceberg is alive. I need more intimacy with the iceberg. From the zodiac, we discover a fragile cave, an opening into the giant. At close range, one can see that the corridor reaches deep into the heart of the Sphinx.
Discovers that there is a tunnel leading down through the center of the iceberg.
Passez-moi la caméra sous-marine.
At the end of the narrow passage lies a basin of dark, therefore deep water, probably connected to the open sea.
Then he reappears through another opening in the honeycombed ice. He has found that there are more tunnels large enough to dive through.
As soon as we're equipped, we slide into it. The basin extends into a vertical well, irregularly shaped, that leads us 60 feet below to a terrace on the flank of the iceberg. There, everywhere, the ice is corrugated by thousands of small depressions. The exact symmetry of design and embossment is incredible. The ice, filled with small air bubbles, is smooth and bright. It was the encounter of freshwater ice and salted seawater that created this improbable surface. Jutting out of the cliff, a sword of ice, a blade, transparent as crystal. A little lower, an opening gapes in the wall. Within the entrails of the Sphinx, dull cracking sounds and alarming fissures are warnings that the iceberg is under immeasurable internal stress. My curiosity is stronger than my apprehension. We are in the natural hall of mirrors. One cannot resist caressing the smooth surfaces that dazzlingly reflect our light. We leave behind the cascading echoes of our bubbles within the palace of ice. Farther down, below a ledge, we discover sheaves of frozen air bubbles, like showers of diamonds. Dominique plays with his light, like a magician. Everything here is made of air and water, water liquid, water solid, water pure and water mixed with air, air that is trapped in microscopic bubbles, shining like pearls, stars, or comets. Our light beams penetrate deep into the transparent ice, revealing the secrets of the iceberg's past. For hundreds of thousands of years, while the iceberg was still part of a glacier, every storm, every winter and summer was engraved in its heart. Now in the sea, it is a giant crystal melting under my eyes. We are witnesses to the vanishing of an eternity.
Jacques-Yves Cousteau est mort mercredi à Paris, il était dans sa 88e.
attends, bouge pas, bouge pas.
France's Jacques-Yves Cousteau, who had revealed to the world the mysteries of the ocean's depths, was laid to rest on land rather than buried at sea in the Navy tradition, according to his widow Francine.
I think he has obliged people to open their eyes on very simple and important things. And he expressed that in such a way that everybody could understand it, from the taxi driver to the head of state.
I think he has become somebody who the public adore for the most part, and who has become a symbol of a human being who really cares, who really wants to make sure that as a species we do everything in our power to protect and improve the quality of our lives. This stubbornness and this enthusiasm is what people will always remember in a very symbolic way of a man that I have loved and continue to love. So my job, as well as others, I suppose, is to continue what he has started and enter the next century full of enthusiasm and make sure that we too do everything we can to make sure that the youth of tomorrow will be able to have the same enthusiasm that was passed on to me.
Soviet Union to South America to Japan, the undersea world of Jacques Cousteau becomes a television hit. Shown in more than 100 countries, it introduces an audience of hundreds of millions to the drama and wonder of the sea.
選ばれた者たちが最後の試練に突進する時、私たちはこの素晴らしい航海者たちに敬意を表さずにはいられません。
Подводная одиссея команды Кусто. Режиссер Филипп Кусто. Композитор Пол Гласс. Посвящается нынешнему и будущим поколениям молодых.
The Undersea World of Jacques Cousteau first airs in January 1968. Audiences quickly adopt the nomadic souls of Calypso. Follow their far-flung adventures, admire the easy camaraderie of captain and crew. Once a ferry boat, the little ship now carries millions on a timeless voyage of discovery. Response to Cousteau's televised expeditions turns the three-year trip into a worldwide quest that still continues nearly two decades later. Calypso and her complement of air and water craft log more than 500,000 miles pursuing Earth's secrets, from dark waters at the bottom of the sea to polar ice at the bottom of the world.
Once in Beijing, the Cousteau team dives in a world of science, splashing the sky as their divers' lamps battle Gorgonian reefs. Since the invention of fireworks, China bedazzles the night with its magic luminous symbols. Such characters written in the sky are the joint patrimony shared not only by the Chinese community, but also by many Asian people.
And for Cousteau in Paris, it means both opportunity and burden. the press of managing voyages, inventions, and science is complicated further. It is 7 a.m. at Orly Airport outside Paris. Cousteau arrives for his regular flight to Nice. It is the beginning of a week in which a film crew will follow Cousteau to record his life away from expeditions. Nearly every day begins or ends or both in an airport. A keen reader, Cousteau uses his time in the air to keep abreast of science, politics, technology, tearing out articles to pass on to his staff. In Nice, he rushes to a helicopter for the short flight east to Monaco. About once a week, he spends time at the Oceanographic Museum of Monaco, founded by Prince Albert. Cousteau has been director since 1957. Though he travels constantly, Monaco is Cousteau's home on land. His only car is here. He and Simone have lived in the apartment house in the center of the screen nearly 20 years. Yet neither is here often. Camera shy, adamant about remaining behind the scenes, Simone has spent more time aboard Calypso than her husband or sons.
She's the permanent and original source of Calypso's spirit. The crew has long called her la bergère, the shepherdess, because she takes care of them, keeps them healthy, well-fed, and out of trouble in ports around the world. I'd like to add to this that very often I wonder if the real captain behind the scene is not la bergère, my mother.
Next day, he returns to Paris, where he keeps a three-room apartment on a quiet, dead-end street. His Paris flat is his refuge. Here, he occasionally seals off the world for an hour, fueling himself with the inspirations of music and poetry. Trained as a classical pianist, he has a vast library of music. He sits at a piano infrequently these days, but occasionally picks up his accordion or a new electronic keyboard. To supervise the final production of his many films, Cousteau has outfitted an editing room directly below his own flat. Catherine Mabila is one of two chief editors who, working with producers, writers, composers, and assistants, turn raw Cousteau footage into finished films at editing rooms in Paris, New York, and Los Angeles. Cousteau keeps no car in Paris, prefers taking the metro on his endless round of meetings with scientists, bankers, publishers, politicians, and potential financial supporters. His office near the Arc de Triomphe is one of four where Cousteau directs work on environmental issues and education. Cousteau's nonprofit operation spans Europe, America, and Calypso at sea, all linked by telephone, telefax, and telex. With 33-year veteran Albert Falco, now captain of Calypso, Cousteau inspects rehabilitation work on his vessel at a St. Augustine shipyard. Cousteau has lost count of the times Calypso has been repaired, remodeled, and even nearly rebuilt at dockyards the world over. He and Jean-Michel now prepare the ship for her 53rd mission, a five-year round-the-world journey to rediscover the planet. And so Cousteau faces the future, ever curious, optimistic, camera in hand.
Those first 75 years, I spent them amazed by nature, bedazzled by the exuberance of life, but worried by its fragility. Now, for the next 75 years and beyond, the spirit that inspired me must live on. And it is you, Jean-Michel, who will carry further the flame of my faith.
What are you doing with this torch?
Huh? Surprise!
What kind of surprise? Tell me what!
No, we will not tell you.
Nope. You won't?
No.
It's what to see?
You'll see, I know, but surprise.
It's a birthday cake.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
You see, Pierre, if you are holding a torch, the flame here is a symbol since antiquity. The flame is a symbol of knowledge. And it's the legend of Prometheus bringing the fire of knowledge on Earth, and he was punished for that. But we brought the flame of knowledge underwater with special torches.
Storm-driven icebergs have destroyed many ships. Subdued light, an atmosphere of slumbering threat as we approach our destination.
It's snowing. The temperature, both in the sea and in the air, has dropped abruptly. Studying the charts, with regret, I prepare our return. I did not suspect that this first snowfall would soon turn into a fierce blizzard. In the meantime, Philippe and Falco organize the last dives before the onslaught of winter. Nobody on board yet realizes the urgency of our situation. The Zodiac sails away on the sea blanketed by a snow that does not melt. As I see them go, I feel vaguely apprehensive.
These penguins are mostly adelie juveniles, left behind by their parents, which have already left the rookeries to feed at sea. The adolescent offspring must soon migrate from the sterile shores to the ice floes, so that they too can find food in the sea during the long winter months ahead. Because of the basic simplicity of life cycles in the Antarctic, the behavior of animals can be more easily observed and interpreted. Young penguins under early winter conditions are good examples of adaptation to extreme environmental challenges.
The bay is in the process of freezing. Some of the penguins have already settled on ice floes. The juveniles will stay at sea for 4 years, feeding underwater, using the...
We land on an ice floe already occupied by a few young ones. As children do, they play catch with the snow as it falls.
Now the divers prepare to film the penguins' migration from the nearby rocky shoreline to the floating ice.
Our divers wear completely watertight, dry suits that are inflated to provide insulation in the frigid water. The penguin's protection against the extreme cold is his full-dress suit of oily feathers. Physiologists are studying human adaptation to South Polar stresses. Much has been learned from the warm-blooded penguins, who can frolic for hours in freezing seas that would in minutes kill an unprotected man.
It is so cold that snow sticks to the camera. It does not even melt upon contact with the water. We swim under a translucent canopy between columns of ice in a world with no shadows. Soon the penguins join us and offer a fantastic display of underwater agility.
The snow is still falling when Philippe terminates the dive. The inflated dry suit may add buoyancy in the water, but it's cumbersome on land. The men prepare to return to Calypso. For a last fling in the water, Dominique Soumillon has blown up his suit to most impressive proportions. Philippe is not to be outdone. Soumillon takes to the water unencumbered by tanks, and the Antarctic Sea becomes a swimming hole. Like an inflated bullfrog, Philippe follows. It is a toss-up as to which bullfrog will become king of this pond. Aboard Calypso, via satellites, Cousteau is in contact with NASA.
Did you ask me about the weather conditions we are now? According to the satellites' photographs that we have at our eyes, and according to what I see through my window, they coincide pretty well. Very sad, gray weather with moderate winds. And now we are beginning to have a glowing sea, and there is a fairly strong depression coming from the west, and that is probably going to hit us tomorrow.
Cutting an open lane through the slushy sea, the divers return to Calypso as the snow continues to fall.
After conferring with NASA, I realized that although now the water is calm and the wind is quiet, things will be changing rapidly. The wind may blow down from the glacier mountains at any moment. Already the barometer has dropped and the seas are freezing around us. Perhaps we have stayed too long.
The divers are back aboard. A long, smooth swell is up now with no wind, a bad omen. February 9, the barometer is falling and the birds are flying away. All of a sudden, the wind has come up. In 5 minutes, it reaches 65 miles per hour. The wind is pushing the icebergs towards the entrance of the deep narrow bay, ending snow. A gigantic mass of ice, many times the weight of Calypso, is on a collision course with us. And there is nothing we can do.
That's very good. Répétez, répétez. Bien reçu.
I know Calypso has been severely injured. I send Falco below to assess the damage. Meanwhile, Zuena continues his futile efforts against the relentless assault. When Falco returns, the wind is stronger than ever. And although by now it has driven most of the icebergs away from us and toward the open sea, the damage has been done. Falco reports that not only is the starboard propeller bent, but the shaft of the port propeller is broken. It is even more serious than I thought. The shaft cannot be repaired.
Philippe Cousteau leads an emergency dive beneath the stern of injured Calypso. The seas of Hope Bay are still turbulent. The men chance a dive ladder for their descent.
The damage wrought by the colliding ice is alarming. The shaft of the port propeller has been knocked out of its socket. We have completely lost the use of this propeller. The divers must fasten the shaft so that it does not ram into our port rudder and disable us completely. Through hand signals relayed by divers to Paul Zuena on the winch, the propeller shaft is secured by a strong tackle.
Although the starboard propeller has also been damaged, the divers dare not tarry to attempt to repair it. The barometer is going down, and the blizzard at Hope Bay worsening. Calypso must lift anchor.
The blizzard is just beginning, and it is turning day into night. With no visibility, in waters too deep to cast an anchor, day after day we circle helplessly in the narrow bay on our single bent propeller. Without radar, we would be wrecked. On the third day, the wind goes up to 100 knots, 120 miles an hour. Already loaded with snow, Calypso is lashed by a freezing spray that makes her even heavier. At last, the storm abates, and I have my first opportunity to check out our poor ship. The deck is heavily loaded with snow and ice. All riggings are covered with thick frost. The winch is a mass of ice and most certainly could not operate. The diving saucer, unrecognizable, has been turned into a large white egg. With one injured propeller and a hole in the hull, our trip back seems very much in doubt. Calypso has a 5 degrees starboard list. I estimate she's loaded with about 30 tons of snow and ice. She's dangerously top heavy and could possibly capsize if a storm hit her again. Meanwhile, we begin digging out our ship. The hole in her hull, 2 feet above the waterline, is temporarily sealed. The rear anchor chain is free. The depression is moving away. It is time to start the motor and leave this dismal bay. The exit of the Weddell Sea is strangely calm, an atmosphere of slumbering threat. Here, icebergs driven by unpredictable squalls and suddenly freezing seas have destroyed many ships. All at once, the face of a glacier collapses. The cliffs are undermined and cracked by the repeated freezings and thawings that occur at the end of summer.
Clear waters ahead turn into a field of drift ice pushed toward Calypso by erratic currents.
We must maneuver carefully through deceptively small growlers. Our wooden hull is scraped as we encounter even larger ice blocks.
Proceeding at about half a knot, Calypso bores on. The channel is now so packed, the ice blocks cannot be avoided.
Our strong steel bar pushes an ice block that should not cause much trouble. But it has a protruding ice tongue hidden 5 feet below the water. We hit it. The ice block bounces back, striking Calypso under the rear, where our vulnerable rudders and propellers are. We lower a TV camera to assess the extent of the damage.
In the ship's mess hall, the TV monitor reveals that one of the two propellers is bent. Since one blade is bent backward and another forward, Philippe Cousteau believes the propeller may have been hit by two ice blocks. They have to proceed to the protection of Palmer Station and repair it there.
The damaged propeller sets up dangerous vibrations at full speed, so we are obliged to travel at no more than 5 knots. With limited visibility, we come upon an uncharted hidden reef, identified only by the waves created by the submerged rocks. You can trust no map here. We are not much better off than early navigators with their primitive charts.
Calypso heads for shelter at Palmer Station, the nearby American base. All ships in the area, including Calypso, have been alerted to the plight of a solitary mariner lost for 2 months in Antarctic seas. 3 days later, at Palmer Station, the saga of Dr. David Lewis ends. A launch helps him tie up to Calypso. Dr. Lewis has sailed from Australia in an attempt to circumnavigate Antarctica alone. But crashing waves capsized his 32-foot sloop, the Iceberg, breaking its mast and knocking out his radio. Sea-soaked for 2 months in freezing temperatures, he has somehow survived.
Messages saying that everybody was without news from you. Every ship afloat in this area was alerted and eager to find you. And when did you have your accident to the mast?
2 months, 27th of November.
What? You're navigating 2 months with that little thing?
2,500 miles away. I got my fingers frostbitten when the boat turned over. And I had to get the water out. I lost their gloves.
How are your fingers now?
Much better. Oh, much better. They were just falling. But the nails...
And the nails are going to fall off?
Or? They will fall off.
Yeah. I see.
Via satellite, a belated Christmas message will be sent by Magnifax to Dr. Lewis's daughters, Vicky 10 and Susie 11. I miss you both so much. Hope you are not too worried. Was your Christmas nice? I shared mine with the little icebergs. I love my girls more than anything in the world, Daddy. Dr. Lewis is bewildered, dubious about the space-age transmission of this message, so important to him.
And we are ready to transmit in 10 seconds.
Calypso, this is ARC. We got an excellent copy on this. Very good. We'll send this on. Very interesting about Dr. David Lewis. We'll see you tomorrow at 18:30 hours.
It is time we left the coast and escaped to the open sea. Along with danger and drama, Antarctica offers us magnificent days that no one on board will ever forget. Bougarin and I study ice conditions revealed by satellite photos. Our immediate objective is King George Island to obtain assistance for our crossing of the Drake Passage. First, Calypso must get out of Hope Bay through the narrow, ice-clogged Antarctic Sound. Our reconnaissance helicopter goes ahead to show us the way out. It is to lead us through the ice toward the low sun over the sea.
Helicopter returns to lead them through the obstruction immediately ahead.
Ce qui m'intéresse, c'est de savoir si la barrière que nous avons devant nous là actuellement, si en allant vers l'ouest, à quelle distance on peut la contourner à toi.
Calypso, pursued by Winter, is led by the helicopter to the ice-free waters that lead to King George Island. Wounded Calypso must now face the challenge of recrossing the treacherous Drake Passage to the tip of South America. By radio, Cousteau confers with Bougarin, Calypso's skipper, who has gone to the Chilean station at King George for meteorological information before they attempt the crossing. Bougarin reports they should sail immediately. An unusual lull between storms may be expected in the Drake Passage, in which there is normally a storm every 3 days. Cousteau states that this information is confirmed by photos from American satellites. It will take disabled Calypso 4.5 days to cross. Cousteau must take advantage of the opportunity right away. A Chilean gunboat will accompany them. They will go.
Ok, bon, eh bien, on va lancer le moteur alors.
Calypso begins her journey across the Drake Passage. Out of the early morning mist, her Chilean escort, the Yelcho, appears. Growling along 5 knots on her single bent propeller, Calypso enters the waters feared by seamen as the roughest in the world.
In addition to the Yelcho, NASA and NOAA satellites, as well as the US Navy's Fleet Weather Service, are keeping constant watch on our damaged ship. If our vibrating propeller shaft should break, leaving our ship dead in the water during the next storm, we would need the Yelcho to tow us to safety. The sudden appearance of dolphins off our bow tells us that we are at last nearing land. The traditional friends of the sailor have joined our escort.
Calypso, Calypso, this is Lock Stewart at Goddard. Contact us when you reach safe water. When you reach safe water.
Look, I can tell you that we did reach safe water. We are now approaching the entrance of the Maury Channel, and we are in safe water. Over.
Contact Houston. We're all going to drink a toast to you on that. We're just real glad to hear that you're in safe water. Over.
Off the tip of South America, Captain Cousteau leaves Calypso in a Zodiac to pay a visit to the Chilean gunboat. To the Chileans, from the French oceanographer, it is a warm salute to the hands across the sea spirit, which transcends all national barriers. Cousteau boards the Yelcho to express his appreciation to its crew and its captain. Lieutenant Commander Carrasco welcomes Captain Cousteau.
After repairs, Calypso will soon be on her way home. The new information we gathered in joint research with NASA will require long analysis. Calypso has successfully probed the most dangerous of waters. Assaulted by icebergs and besieged by savage storms, she has survived.
In spite of her wounds, Calypso has carried us through our greatest and most daring adventure. We were in quest of the unknown, but rediscovered what our ancestors once knew, harmony and purity on our planet. We have confirmed that the southern polar waters are the richest of the world's oceans. May this continent, the last explored by man, be the first one to be spared by man. May out of the errors of the past rise a dawn of respect and love for the free living creatures and pristine beauty of the last virgin land on Earth, Antarctica.